Somebody need to do a song for L.A. Straight up.
Just go out to L.A. The new anthem. California Love Part 2.
What?
To live in L.A. West side. West side. West side. To live and die in L.A., where everybody try to fatten their pocket. So many hustle for the cash, so it's hard to knock it. Everybody got their own thing, currency chasing. Worldwide through the hard times, worrying faces. Shed tears as we bury brothers close to heart. What was a friend, now a ghost in the dark. Hard part about it, brother got smoke by a fiend.
Well, hello, hello, hello. God bless your community family, and welcome to Gang Talk with Sister Heron and Skip Townsend. Now, Skip may look a little different tonight because he's in Atlanta, bless his heart, and we're so proud of him. And, you know, we want you to know that these are sons and family members his sister has adopted. So they're all a part of my family now, and we're proud and grateful to have them with us. So Skip is in Atlanta, and he's trying to train them and show them the kinds of things that we're doing in Los Angeles that are working for our community. Now, as you can see, we have important folks here tonight, and we're so happy to have them. One we're still waiting for, but the truth is, I've been a big fan. I've been a big fan of theirs for many years, and that's our special beloved Dr. Cecil Murray.
Thank you, Lita. I am president of your fan club.
Such kind words, but you know, I don't have my background established like yours is, so when I grew up, I want to be like you. But you know, being close, I want that to rub off this way and rub off on our young men. So God bless you, and thank you so much for coming.
God bless you.
Now, what we wanted to do, I did a thorough disclosure of your history on the first show that we did online, and that was the leap year date, February 29th. So that in itself is unique.
Yes.
To have that conversation with you and John Mack on the 29th of February in 2016. So that's just kind of a stand by itself. So we are waiting for Mr. Mack and another guest because it's a very important conversation we had hoped to have tonight. So we're just going to go, and we come on at the worst time for traffic in Los Angeles, and we know that's always a delay. So we're going to be patient because they are expected and they are confirmed. So what we're going to do, we're going to move right along and just introduce Dr. Murray here. For those that don't know, he's history, legend in the city of Los Angeles, legendary, and that comes with his stewardship of the first AME church in Los Angeles. And the truth of that is that church was built by a former slave, Biddy Mason. Back in 1855, in the 1850s, she was brought to California, where she was able to get with the locals and free herself. She was able to free herself, and after she freed herself, she was able to get meaningful employment as a midwife and various other things. And by the time Biddy was done, she owned a lot of property on Spring Street in downtown Los Angeles. So we honor her, and along the line, Biddy's son-in-law and Biddy built First AME Church. And so our dear beloved Dr. Cecil Murray was a steward of that sanctuary from 1977 to 2004.
Yes, indeed. And right. What a blessing it was to walk in the legacy of Biddy Mason.
Mm-hmm.
She's remembered as saying, "It is the open hand that is blessed, for with the closed hand, nothing can get in, but nothing can get out either."
That's true. Well, we really want our young people to know their history, because we do have a substantial history in this country, and with people like Biddy Mason that was a pioneer, that made a place for a pioneer like you to come and follow in those footsteps. And so that's the thing that we want to share with our young folks. So We actually ask you to come as the elder and the wise to talk about you, to speak to our spirituality, and Mr. Mack to speak about civil rights and law enforcement. And
yes,
unfortunately, it's been a tough couple of days for the Black nation.
True.
And before we get into that, I want to give our guest, our co-host, a chance to introduce himself and our guest. It's his first time, but won't be the last.
I'm Marcus Woods. I spent a lot of years in prison myself, you know, so I'm kind of honored to be here, you know what I mean? I did a lot of research and read up, you know, to understand who you are and, you know, the things you did for Los Angeles, you know, and I just want to say thank you, you know, so.
And I want you to speak into the mic.
I thought I was speaking.
So everybody can hear you.
That's better?
Yeah, that's better. And I really want to include this part because it's very important. They took Marcus at 17. He left, he was taken from our community at 17, and he served 17 years to the state. So he's back now trying to step back on the path he should have been on at 17. So that's just a little bit about his backstory that makes him my child.
And makes him our hero. Mm-hmm. Do you realize that every year, 120,000 Black males under the age of 18 are taken into prison confinement. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about the jail situation, but you are to be commended. You took the thing working against you and made it work for you.
Thank you.
Right. My name?
Yeah, my name is Kwadim, and this is my first time here. I'm excited to be here. You know, the topics, you know, that are usually discussed are great ones, and I'm appreciative to be a part of this conversation.
And Kwadim, why don't you tell how we met? What brought you here? Come on.
All right. Well, so we met by because my mom, she was getting studio time, and then so we were able to sit in on a discussion they were having, and they were talking about gang violence, like you know, just problems that Black, you know, culture face, mm-hmm. you know, Black people face, you know, together. So, and I was really, really curious. So, what happened? So what happened to me was that just being Black, walking down the street, and I happened to get like shot by some Latino brothers, you know, and yeah. So I just wanted to share that story and share and contribute as much as I can.
Mm-hmm. And that's really the substance of how we became close, is because somebody actually shot at you. You know, and that's a daily occurrence for the men in our community that really put us on the air with Gang Talk, is yeah. that the danger that you're under. And we had really planned on having an uplifting, kind of spiritual, fulfilling kind of conversation tonight. But before we could get to this Thursday, we've had two young men killed by law enforcement. You know, in one in St. Paul and the other one in Baton Rouge.
Yes.
Austin.
Uh-huh. And it's all over Facebook today, just everything on Facebook. There's so much of it on Facebook that Facebook is actually shutting down some of these posts.
Yeah, they're clearing posted.
Yes.
Missing posts.
And missing posts. Mm-hmm.
Indeed. And the list is extensive.
Yes.
Our major states have experienced it. And this is a test for America.
Yes, it is.
Will we rise to the occasion? President Barack Obama delivered a very good presentation today, and it opened the door for us to see we can do better than that.
Let me ask you this way. Hasn't he been trying to open that door for 8 years?
Hmm. Oh, geez. My ministry.
Put you on the spot, didn't I?
My ministry has extended so long, and I have the feeling that there will be a rising of the level of expectation.
Yes.
Because America has got to solve the problem of diversity. Our nation, our states, and so forth, so on, we've got to to solve the question of diversity, because America's a nation of nations. And then if you want to shut some out and let others in, you're just cruising for a bruising, because it's not going to work.
Absolutely. And more specifically, I think, well, in my personal assessment, the black nation needs to wake up. The black nation must wake up. And I'm sorry to have had to suggest this last week, because I didn't thank our panel that came last week, but it was a very candid conversation about the threat to black men.
Yes.
And that it seems from the time of slavery all through the Klan years, all through segregation, all through welfare, and now the drug years, the target's been you.
Yes.
The target has been you.
Yes.
Now, the difference in the generations, his generation used that target to unify us as a people.
Precisely.
And protect our village. This is what the men did. They linked arms because they were all under the same threat. You see, and in the interim, they found a way to pit you against each other. Mm-hmm. That's the thing that's changed between his time and yours.
Right.
So that's why I ask our best leadership, black male leadership in this city historically, to come have this important generational conversation with you. Mm-hmm. So I wanted you to ask him some questions.
And I'll ask you some questions, because we could grow a lot from listening to you. You're the next generation, and I hope you understand that we are pulling for you, pulling with you. We must find a way to get the millennial generation of blacks particularly to understand we must walk together, or we will be blown apart.
Yes.
There is nothing going for us if we are not going for ourselves. The black community was a family community until drugs and weapons came into being, and that opened up the negative doors. Mm-hmm. So to see a person like you, Cardine, is very refreshing. Thank God for you. Give your life to helping lift the brothers.
Well, you know what? I had a working title for this episode tonight. And of course, the theme is African American independence.
All right.
Okay, because we just celebrated the 5th of July.
Yes.
Which is more in tune with our attitude about independence. And African-American independence, is it real or fantasy? Now, my working title was How to Live Our Dreams and Not Our Nightmares Under the Psychosis of Being Black in America. Hmm. We're under a psychosis for our color in this country. And the evidence of it is how law enforcement is doing now.
Yes.
Just without reason, without merit.
It's shooting of black people is more law than intention. You know, it's if I take my career in law enforcement and, you know, use my authority the way that they teach me, I can shoot anybody I want. You know, this guy, you know, the guys that shot Alton, they on paid leave. You know, that's no more saying that, you know, if I shoot you, then, you know, I just get to do, you know, basically to you what I please. And nobody's not going to do nothing until, you know, an investigation that everybody already really see the outcome of. It angers me. I mean, I'm kind of at a loss of words.
Marcus,
you know,
you are so right and righteous. We, of course, would need to say we hope that there are some who are in the police force who are listening in.
Mm-hmm.
We are not painting all policemen with the same brush,
mm-hmm.
but we are painting the system with the brush.
Yes.
Police power is power. And Lord Acton is known for saying power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. So there must be some bonds and some fences, or the power gets out of control. The shooting of unarmed black men has nothing to do with legitimate power. It is power that is out of control, and those who are out of control must be pulled back into the saddle or dismissed. Otherwise, they will cause the nation to fall. We need the police power. They are supposed to be our protectors and our defenders. But the question comes, who will protect us from our protectors and who will defend us from our defenders? In major states, this has been happening, and not just for the last decade or two, but for several centuries, and it's got to come to a stop.
When will enough be enough?
Well, you know, that's what I was suggesting in that, and I hate to say the old days, because they weren't that long ago.
Right.
But that was a core that unified the black nation right there, the outside threat to us, outside threats. And now the outside threats are still there. And thanks to Donald Trump, he's freeing some of them that think that they want to pick up that Klan hood and wear it again and fly the Confederate flag. And I'm on the side that wants to burn that Confederate flag. Right. And, you know, that's my new Facebook challenge. Burn a Confederate flag if you really mean it. Mm. But, and I'm not trying to be make jokes about this. This is a very serious conversation. And two men had their lives stolen this week, just in the last few days.
And they got families, you know, moms, dads, relatives.
One of them, the kid was in the car. Yeah.
Yes, a young man in Minnesota.
Minnesota.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they killed him in the car with his four-year-old daughter in the back seat. You know, no consideration for the family at all. And so, you know, that's very alarming, very disturbing. And that child is traumatized. Traumatized, just as the father, the children of the father in Baton Rouge. Mm. You saw his son was traumatized and going to grow up without his dad and know that his dad was murdered this way. And the bad thing for the black nation, it really needs to wake up and get proactive. These two police officers in Baton Rouge have some kind of bad record, too, on top of it.
Yes.
It's coming out that they have had complaints about their conduct before. And so as we maintain the division amongst our own nation, the black nation, these kinds of things happen. And as you suggested, Marcus, they get paid leave. They get a GoFundMe account to help them with their legal expenses, and they never face judgment for that murder. And so that's our a combined frustration, where we lack the power, where we're divided about things like Black Lives Matter because we don't like the way they protest. You know, we kind of catch ourselves in this catch-22 and watch these things happen, but won't agree on how to confront it. What do we need to do? And so I really didn't want to burden you with all that pressure, because I did want to ask Mr. Mack about our civil rights, the things that we need to be doing as a people to confront this. That, you know, with like the Black Lives Matter, LA is trying to lock them all up.
Yes.
Okay, they want to lock them up, find them, make them disappear. Well, as a black community in the city, we cannot afford to lose Black Lives Matter. We cannot afford to
especially lose. Especially, we need to understand when underserved communities say that Black Lives Matter, they are saying our lives matter too.
That's right.
So you could add Black Lives Matter also to it and change the understanding. They're not saying Black Lives Matter exclusively.
Right.
They're saying all lives matter, including black lives. Our nation has 400 years history of racism.
Yes.
The first five presidents owned slaves.
Yes.
Thomas Jefferson writing, "Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. All men are created equal," and yet he owned slaves. Mm-hmm. 8 of our 44 presidents have owned slaves. We have a history, and yet slave labor, black labor, built the infrastructure of this country.
Yes.
Slave labor built the White House.
Yes.
And when it was destroyed in the Civil War, freed slaves rebuilt the White House.
Right.
And now that the White House has become the Black House with its first black president and all that, we want to say, see, you've arrived, black people. What are you talking about?
Hmm.
And you would hear from the president himself, we have a long way to go.
Mm-hmm.
Look at how the Republicans are treating him.
Mm-hmm.
Look at how the Tea Party are treating him. And here is the person who gives us a health care program when America was the only industrial nation without a universal health program.
Right.
Now, 20 million Americans have health care that didn't have. They put him down.
Mm-hmm.
The Constitution says if there's a vacancy in the Supreme Court, the president can give to the Senate some names or name
right.
who would, and they ignore it and bust it out.
Right.
So it is the White House and the Black House, but we have a long way to go,
mm-hmm.
and we need to wake up and act like it.
You are so right about that. And you know, that was one of the things I wanted to cover with you, because, you know, Jesse Williams,
yes.
young actor that spoke out at the BET
yes.
Awards and got all that pushback for what he said, you know, and made people like me so proud.
Mm.
We were so happy to hear his dialogue. We celebrated it, but 10,000 people actually signed a petition to get that man fired.
Mm.
And we, as a people, are just laughing at the 10,000. You got to be kidding me.
Yes.
When your candidate, not ours, their candidate, Donald Trump,
mm.
has been able to be just as racist and bigoted and say he wants to be president of this country.
Mm.
But yet Jesse Williams speaks out about our black dilemma, and all of a sudden he deserves to be dismissed.
Yes. Wow. Yes.
Come on, Kwadim, I know you got something to say about this.
Yeah, definitely. And that's kind of how it works, you know, kind of in America. Is like, if black people try to stand up for themselves, then they will be either put down or put away.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
yeah,
put down or put away,
pretty much.
Well, you know what, And I'm glad you're here, see, because what I'm seeing, your generation is going to fix this. You're going to fix
it. I hope so.
No, you have been charged. You have been charged by circumstances. You're either going to allow it to continue or you're going to make it stop.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he and I are going to join you, but we're not going to lead the charge. You are. You are. They're not killing me. They're not killing my age group. They're killing yours. And what we really want our young listeners to understand, that's how you annihilate a whole race. You kill the men in the baby-making age. Let me say that one more time. You annihilate a race by killing all the men in the baby-making age.
Hmm.
See, black women can make babies, but they won't look like you.
Hmm.
'Cause you won't be here. You won't be here. And not to understand that your life is at risk that way for annihilation means we're still walking around in darkness, in spiritual darkness, and that this world has convinced you that your life has no value. So we have knuckleheads in Chicago that are living that lie, that we in LA need you to help them wake up.
Yeah, because they do a lot of stuff over there that, you know, it's more copycat than originator.
Yes.
You know, so you got to understand that, you know, half the gangbanging you're trying to do out there, you know, it doesn't amount to where it started at. You know, it's more of you trying to be more of monkey see, monkey do, instead of, you know, I made this innovation myself. And I want to change it into something else, you know. But more people now are just trying to keep up, you know, keep with the Joneses,
You know, it's material. They're searching for the material.
They don't really
value.
Know the origin of what they actually trying to represent, and it changes. You know, it changes everything. You know, because you got guys who, you know, don't really understand the streets that they're representing, and you can go to another state easily and say I'm from here, but you don't even understand what's going on. Now you got a bigger problem elsewhere, and now you got people shooting. For a reason that they think they should be shooting, which, you know, that's stupid, you know, honestly, you know, but.
And it stems from lack of knowing.
Lack of knowledge.
Because it is true. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free.
Exactly.
We don't know our own excellence. Just take, for instance, dear gangbangers, whom we love and hope that you will be moved by common sense and moved by the truth. You were coming here from Africa 600 years before Columbus landed. He landed in 1492 in America, and when he got here, he didn't know where he was. Mm-hmm. When he left here, he didn't know where he had been. But you were coming to America. You plotted the ocean currents and all, and on those charts, you came here and you went down to the Caribbean area. You carved your image onto the mountains down in the Caribbean, and they are there now. A group of professors from Harvard University wanted to check on that story that Africans were coming to America at that early stage. And so they went to Africa. They took some of those ocean charts. They took the same type of boats that had been used by these Africans to come to America, 1100, 2000, so forth, so on, coming to the New World. And they landed the same place that those Africans had landed, following the currents and everything of that nature. We are pathfinders.
Yes.
Take Los Angeles. 23 of the 46 founders of Los Angeles were African Americans. Mm-hmm. The last territorial governor of California before it became a state was Colonel P.O. Pico, a black man after whom Pico Boulevard is named.
That's right.
The northwest of Seattle was opened up by a black man, George Williams Bush, not any kin to that George William Bush.
Not those Texas Bushes.
Yes, the Indians loved him and accepted him, let him go back to Mississippi and Alabama and bring caravans out to the Northwest. Fontana, Allensworth, those are cities founded by blacks.
Wow.
And the Ku Klux Klan once dominated Fontana, not even knowing they were founded by a black man. Mm-hmm. The Midwest, Southwest, Estebanico opened up Phoenix, Arizona territory, when Phoenix didn't want to observe Martin Luther King's birthday at first, but now they do. The Midwest, Charles Pont du Sable, a black man, opened up Chicago and the Midwest and brought it on. Benjamin Banneker, a black astronomer, laid out the floor plan for Washington, D.C., the capital.
Yes.
We are pathfinders. We open up doors to this country. We built the infrastructure of this country. Nobody can tell us we don't belong here. Only we can tell that to ourselves.
You know, and I just love to hear you talk. I really do, because young people need to hear this wisdom. Really, we didn't just show up yesterday. We didn't just show up yesterday.
Well, they're not teaching that in the textbooks.
They're sure not.
So,
look, teach that when I was
it's born. His story. It's his story. That's why it's called history, because it's his story.
Yeah.
They don't want to hear your story. They don't want to hear our story. They're teaching his story.
Mm.
He's the one in control, and he don't care what your story is. You see, so we have to teach our story, the story they want us to forget.
Mm.
You see, and no offense to Snoop. I love you, Snoop, because you have turned a big corner, and I'm happy about it. But when we come against programs like Roots, we're getting in break time. Are we at break?
What is your point?
Okay, I just want, I forgot my thought already, because when she said break, I broke.
I think you said something about Snoop.
All right. You said something about Snoop.
You know, he wasn't happy with the remake of Roots. Okay, he wants to see another story. The truth is, Roots really wasn't made for us, except to clarify the misinterpretations. But it was made for them to see what they did to us. Right. We don't need to relive that nightmare, but it is good for us to never forget it. Never forget it.
Well done. So we're on a break now?
Yeah, we're on a break, Stevie.
Okay, Simmons. This is good.
God bless you, community family, and welcome back to Gang Talk. That was a nice short break because this is a very important conversation, and we don't want to lose a moment of it.
Right.
And where did we leave off?
He was talking about Snoop.
You know, I don't really want to target that arena, but the truth is there's been a lot of murder in it. There's been a lot of hate, a lot of murder, and a lot of lyrics that have not been good for us as a people, that have condoned internal violence, that has condoned the murder, black-on-black murder. And we have to address that. We have to address that because with my sons growing up, there was some music I didn't want them to listen to, but they was going to listen to it anyway.
Yes.
You see, and what did they get from it? So I'm going to give that to you.
Okay, well, I'm just gonna start off with I read that that the big wigs or like the head honchos at like these prison companies they went and told had a meeting with like the music industry and told them like, hey, this is the type of music that we want you to listen to, or we want you to play, you know, for the black youth, so that way you subconsciously get sucked into like this type of like lifestyle that's not good or healthy for us.
And we need to understand the background of the prison system, because America leads the world in prison construction and prison confinement. Yeah. America leads the world, and California leads America. 2.2 million persons in prison, 50% of them blacks, 35% Latinos, Hispanics. 90% of those blacks who are there because of substance abuse crimes, non-violent crimes. And the Federal Judicial Council says for a white man to get the same sentence as a black man for substance abuse, the white man has to use 100 times as much powder cocaine as the black man uses crack cocaine. And the two of them are basically the same. Mm. If anyone is cheaper, it's crack cocaine watered down a little bit so they can sell it easier on the streets.
And very addictive.
Yes.
Very addictive.
And when you look at the prison population, there are several factors that account for it being filled with underserved blacks and browns. One, when the prison system was privatized, as long as it was with the government, all right. But the moment you privatized it, those private owners say, we're going to keep this place not only full, but overfilled. Mm-hmm. Because right now, we taxpayers pay $25,000 to $45,000 a year to keep a man a year in prison.
Right.
When for $15,000, $16,000 a year, you could keep him a year in college.
In college.
Then the other thing, under the Reagan administration, the prison mentality was changed from one of rehabilitation to one of punishment. Mm-hmm. Prisoner goes in, is in 3, 4, 5, 6, 10, 15 years, comes out with no training. Mm-hmm. There has been no rehabilitation at all. It's just punishment. We have to find a way to prepare them, or the recidivism rate will remain the same. The rate is 1 out of 3 prisoners released is back in prison within 3 years. Mm-hmm. So here we are. Proposition 47 comes along. They reach into the list of violent crimes and pull out 6 categories of what are no longer violent crimes, but are called misdemeanors. Mm-hmm. Misdemeanors, one of them is substance abuse crimes and arrests. So because the jails are overcrowded, says the Supreme Court, and unhealthy, and thus defy the Constitution, which prohibits inhumane treatment, then those who are misdemeanors must be released from prison for violent crimes. So they designed a plan, and the original plan would say $100 million to $200 million would be taken to recycle those prisoners going out. Housing, job training, substance abuse counseling, mental health, because 30% of prisoners are there with mental problems.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And they're released and they come right back in. So far, our state has not done much about making sure that that money from the release of prisoners is used to rehabilitate them. Mm-hmm. So far, not $100 million, not $200 million, but only $19 million has been set aside. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have to make certain that as these prisoners come out, we follow that standard, we follow the thing that we voted on, and we must make certain that there is rehabilitation for them so that they can have a different life.
Yeah, because inside the prisons, they actually taking all the programs. When I left, I came home in 2012. They was taking all the vocational programs. They was trying to keep the youngsters in school.
Yes.
But that didn't really work out because they tried to also do like the older guys the same way, and they rejected that thought. Like, you know, I already got life. I don't got to go to school every day. You know, right. So they started taking vocational programs, and I want to say this. All right, contrary to people's belief, when they tell you that they're using those monies for programs with, you know, rehabilitation and all that, that's not happening. You know, I came home, like I said, I came home 4 years ago almost. In 10 days, I've been home 4 years. You know, and I have yet to see anything different than when I left in 1995. You know, you got people sending kids to prison at the age of 15, literal prisons. You know, you got all these different motives and laws that, like I said, they took all the programs and, you know, it's an intent and outcome to keep, you know, all these black youth, you know, within these walls. So they, you know, like you said, you can't produce, you know, when you got somebody sitting behind a wall and you can't get married at the age of 15. So, you know, you can send somebody's kid to prison and then, you know, you come back with a law that states, no child left behind. It's a joke.
It is.
You know, it's really a joke. You can't say no child is left behind when you're sending children to prison.
And like, when you get to children in prison, 60% of the children of prisoners become prisoners themselves.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
So I just want to say, like, how, because I'm a little confused by this matter. It's you got children that are 15, 16, 17, and they get charged as adults.
As adults.
And they, you know, get 15.
But they tell the public that they're going to send them to YA. Okay, this kid got a YA number. The number is the difference.
Speak into the mic.
If he goes to YA,
with this number, youth authority with this number, then, you know, once he turns 18, we can automatically send him to prison, you know.
And, adult prison.
Yeah, and they already doing that. When you get 15, they got, like I said before, you know, they got a whole entire yard for youth at Tehachapi Prison, you know, and it's called the Youth Offender Program. It was, you know, they were sending kids left and right from juvenile hall.
Yes.
You know, and telling people that, you know, these kids are going to youth authority. They're not. You know, they're sending them straight to state prisons.
Yeah, every year 120,000 youth under 18 are confined.
Yeah.
I wanted our young people to recognize that. You see, because they take you at 18, it turns into a life sentence.
Yeah, it turns into a life.
They put that choke chain around your neck called probation, parole. We had your name in the system. That follows you around to the grave. And our men just seem to just run in that direction blindly, not looking at the big picture or what it's going to cost them in the overall. Okay? And so, Marcus, we give you grace because you got caught up in a time that wasn't meant for you to survive. It really was not meant for you to survive. Mm-hmm. But bless God, you did. And you didn't come out crazier than you were when you went in. Mm-hmm. You came back in your right mind. Now we have Quadim. He's in his 20s. Mm-hmm. We've got to make his generation understand. We shut those prison doors.
Mm-hmm.
Black men got no business going up in there. And if you've gone in there, you made the choice. You made that decision when your community wants you to stay here and be the men of our village, be the fathers to our children, be the big brothers, the big homies that protect our village.
And particularly when you look at 1 million black men in the prison at this tick of the watch, that's 1 million potential fathers.
Yes.
So then the children have no fathers, and our women, the only women on the planet who don't have a ready supply of husbands, the males, 1 million in prison, the poverty rate in underserved communities is double that of the national poverty rate, and you go on and you go on and you go on. So then the nuclear family is in disarray. Young men come up, they find a prison. I mean, they find gang as their family, their extended family. In my generation, you have the nuclear family, mama, daddy, children. And then you had the extended family, the neighbors. And if you acted the fool in the street, bad news would beat you home, even though we didn't have telephones.
Yes,
the neighbors would, the boy, you had to have it there. But now we have not enough of a support base for those persons. So you've experienced prison. You see that it's just a net to entrap underserved communities and to make money off of slave labor. It's the new Jim Crow. And it is accepted, but it is costing America so much now that they've got to do something. The Supreme Court has ruled against it and all of that. So we've got to find a way to reinvent ourselves. So the young men in gangs, we need you to be a positive gang and not a negative gang.
Yeah. And
take care of
children. I just feel like that it's kind of hard when, you know, you're out there looking for a job and people won't hire you because you're black. So then you got to resort to any means necessary to feed your family, you know, and then you go to prison for, you know, for that reason. And just feel like it's a terrible cycle.
It is a terrible cycle, but look. This man was born under that segregation.
Yes.
Survived under that segregation.
Yes.
My dad survived under that segregation where black men could not get a job.
Right.
And look, it hasn't changed. In 2016, it's still the same thing. So, but the men of their generation solved that by having a trade. wasn't who they knew, it was what they knew how to do. And so we had black mechanics, we had accountants, we had grocers, we had store owners, we had barbershops, we had black men that sustained businesses in our village because they couldn't get work outside. Mm. You see, and it hasn't changed. If anything, it's gotten worse because now you're labeled a thug and a dangerous threat.
And we don't understand the African proverb. It's not the name you call me, it's the name I answer to.
Hmm.
See, we've already said we are pathfinders and looked at how we open up the major portions of our nation. Now, we need to understand we are providers. As you drove here, that stoplight that you stopped at was invented by someone who was one of us. That mailbox was invented by one of us. The slaves built the White House we've seen.
Peanut butter.
The blood bank was set up by blacks. No. The telegraph was invented by a black man. Skyscrapers were invented by blacks. The elevators were invented by blacks.
Mm-hmm.
The refrigerator, or else we couldn't freeze our chicken and our turkeys and all that, were invented by blacks. And one young slave lad, can you imagine, age 13, he was sold in exchange for an old plug mule. But he had a mind that was open. He took a peanut as the years went by and pulled 300 products out of that peanut, including women's lipstick, men's aftershave lotion and all, took a potato. And he pulled 116 products out of it, including shoe polish and cornstarch. Name, George Washington Carver.
Yes.
Hmm. Congress thought so highly of him, they sent for him to come because they wanted to award him a congressional medal. He was sitting outside the door waiting for them to call him inside to honor him when one of the white men walked by and asked him, "What you doing here, boy? You ain't got no business here." He said nothing, and soon they came and got him. And when they were getting ready to introduce him, the senator from Mississippi said, "Now, Mr. Carver, congratulations. I hear it say that you said, of course, that the Bible told you about the peanut." I've taught the Bible in Sunday school for 20 years. I've read the Bible, as they say, from kibber to kibber. But nowhere have I seen the Bible mention the peanut. George Washington Carver said, "Yes, Senator, you are right. The Bible doesn't mention the peanut. The Bible told me about God, and God told me about the peanut."
We have
to understand we are providers. We will find a way to make it happen. When you look at so many of the items that you use daily, they are invented by blacks, like automobile automatic transmission.
Well, let's just talk about the light bulb.
Yes.
Okay, because if it wasn't for that young brother working with Edison, we wouldn't have the light bulb on right now. Edison made it come on, but he couldn't make it stay
Edison,
on.
Edison said, "I couldn't have done it without the invention of those two filaments."
The filaments.
And the light bulb. I couldn't have invented it. And those filaments were invented by black man.
Yes, yes. And I'm ashamed of myself because I keep forgetting his name. But you know, when you see Thomas Edison, you're going to see this man's name because he's the one, the reason that we're sitting under lights right now. Right now. And so there, the point we're trying to make, there's genius in us, natural genius in us. And my joke about George Washington Carver, how long has that peanut been in the world?
All right.
All the time the peanut's been in the world, but it took this black man to take it and make something with it. The one thing he didn't make was peanut butter.
Right.
We have to clear that up. He didn't. Okay. Peanut butter was not his invention.
Something with peanut.
Well, yes, he made all kinds. Well, see, the oil.
Yeah.
The oil became the byproduct.
Do you guys remember when automobiles had clutches?
Yeah.
You had to step on the clutch, shift the gear, step on the clutch, shift to second gear, then come down third gear.
They don't know about that. They heard about it, but they don't.
Brother comes along.
I thought he was talking about a clutch and a stick. Right.
Brother comes along and invents automatic transmission. Now, it's cool.
Yeah.
It is something there. We are providers, same as we are pathfinders. We've got to know our record, our positive history. And it's not the name you call me. Call me lazy, call me stupid, call me dumb. It's not the name you call me. It's the name I answer to. And we need to read more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
They are there. The library has them. The bookstore has
them. They got them online.
Take some time.
He just gave you the clue. It got to be online.
Yes.
They'll read it if it's online. They'll read it if it's on Google. Right. If it's online. If it's on Facebook, they'll read it.
Yes.
They don't have to go to the library no more. They could just, you know, type it in.
The library is online.
Yep.
And I'm so sorry to say, it's captured me too. I got a library so close, I'm ashamed to tell you how close it is. But boy, I Google everything.
Right.
I was Googling today about you.
Me too. I was too.
Yeah. So it's a new age.
Google works if you use it, right?
Yeah,
well, the
it
beauty
right.
about it, that toy is for your generation. Our generation, which really doesn't want to learn these new technologies, you know, because we're used to the old ways, nothing wrong with that. But we want you to expand that knowledge, teach our kids. You're the rebuilders.
Hmm. Yes.
He's a builder, but you're the rebuilders.
You bet.
And that's really what we want your generations to understand. You have a stake in this. Hmm. This is the black nation. This is the black village. And as Skip said last week, it takes a village to raise one child. That's what that quote is. One child. It doesn't say anything about the village raising all of you. But you see, we need the village to raise all of us, mm-hmm. all of you. And so you're part of a bigger picture here. And that's why I asked Dr. Murray and Mr. Mack to join us tonight to share that generational connection with you. That's what was lost.
Right.
You were born into violence. Actually, the violence stole your youth and almost stole yours.
Yes.
And we have to stop that madness, that internal madness that took over, sent us to prison. Send us to the cemetery?
Yes.
We have to stop that because that is not who we really are.
Right.
That's not who we are. That's not who the black man is. That's
no,
not who we
are. Not at our best.
No.
No, not at our best.
Not at all.
Yeah, we got cops ready to shoot black people just left and right. Like, that's like law or something.
Yeah.
You know, it's crazy. We gotta stop that. And even black on black crime. Or black on brown, or you know, or what have you. We got to stop that too.
I think people just really need to not be afraid to speak up. Yeah. You know, it's come to a point where everybody just don't want to say nothing. You could talk to the person like most people could sit. I can talk to him sitting next to me, but you know, when it come down to it, nobody got nothing to say. You know, everybody gossips and talk about TMZ, but stuff like this, it's easy to post it on Facebook.
Yes, that's a saying. Great minds talk about ideas. Small minds talk about people.
Mm-hmm.
Just gossiping, putting people down. Blah, 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 so on, so on, so on. Just as with racists, he calls you no good nigga. So on, so on, so on.
Man, huh?
Hmm.
You look at him. Is that your challenge?
Hmm.
Of course not. So you go to school, and one of the brothers, you know, we can be pretty rough on each other. Man, where you what's wrong with your nose? You've got to fight the big battles.
Big picture, yes.
Our gang mates, friends, who were the extended family in gangs, fight the big battles. Don't fight the small battles. Don't fight each other. Fight against the system that's putting people down. Help the helpless, house the homeless, lift the fallen, give sight to the blind, give life to the dead. Don't hurt anyone. Lift.
And you know, I was just going to ask you to impart some words of wisdom. I didn't even have to say go. I love that about you. You know, all we have to do is give you a subject and you just share such excellent words that our young people really deserve to hear.
They deserve to hear. A miraculous generation. This century will be their proving grounds.
Yes.
Right now, it's kind of hard to pull the millennials into the church. But then in American churches, generally, we have a 60% dropout rate. Yeah. 96% of Americans believe in God, but 50% of Americans will say, I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious.
Right.
Religion has to reinvent itself.
Yeah.
In the last 4,000 years of history, we've had less than 300 years of peace, and most of those wars are religious wars, like ISIS in the Middle East, killing, blowing up themselves in the name of God and killing. And we can't go jumping on Islam or Christianity or Judaism or Buddhism. We've got to find a way to make a way for sanity.
Yes.
And, sanity.
You know, as we talk about the radical Muslims, we have the Jonesboro Baptist Church, radical Christians right here on this soil.
Slavery was blessed by the Christian church in America.
There it is. Mm. There it is. You see, so, you know, our community has a lot of work to do. The beauty for me is that this generation is awake now. They are awake.
Yes.
They are awakening. They're not going to be deceived.
You bet.
They're not. And I bless God that our young victim has come back in his right mind.
Right.
He's part of the rebuilding here.
Yes.
That we're not going to settle for less.
Mm.
Thanks to you. Thanks to you. Because, you know, our mothers, our women, our children deserve you.
Mm. Yes.
They deserve you. And we're just so happy that you're here. We want you to survive.
I could do more out here than I can in there.
You bet.
Exactly.
Well said. Well said.
All day long.
I go to prisons maybe 3 times a month and so forth and so on. And I have about 17 guys that I'm in regular communication with. And they, under different circumstances, would be able to make great contribution. Their minds are good. They just need a slightly different mindset. When they are released, just commit. I am going to lift.
Hmm.
To lift. Not even to look at myself being lifted, but to help others. I'm going to do something about education. The dropout rate in underserved schools, blacks and browns, is 50%. The majority of them dropping out in eighth grade.
Mm.
Going into the 21st century with an eighth grade education, when everybody knows that in a lifetime, a high school graduate earns 3 times as much income as a high school dropout.
Yes, sir.
And a college graduate earns 3 times as much as a high school graduate. Yes. Education is not an option. Mm. It's a necessity. So, all right, dad is in prison. Mama may be a little bit on drugs, but there's somebody that believes in you enough to help you go to school.
Yes.
There's somebody that believes in you enough to help you find an after-school job so you can have some spare money. There's somebody in there who will help you find a positive step.
Hmm.
That person is waiting.
Hmm. That's right. That's the rebuilding we need to happen in our village. Is to fill those gaps just as you suggested, because we have gaps and we need gap fillers.
Hmm.
We really do. And so, you know, for the young men that are angry and locked up and say that it was unfair and the law worked against them and you're going to study the law, well, do that.
Yes.
Instead of sitting in your cell being mad, study the law. When you come out here, be a paralegal.
Beautiful.
They may not give you a law license, but you can be a paralegal and advise us of our rights. And I know people will throw dollars at you for that.
That's true.
So I think, yeah, I hear our wrap-up music. Yes. So God bless you,
God
Dr.
Bless
Murray.
You guys.
You know, we're going to have you back. I told you I'd make you a regular.
You call our hall.
Wadim, thank you for coming tonight. And Marcus, thank you for filling in for Skip. And Mr. Mack, you know, we always miss you, but we know you tried to get here, so we're going to make it happen. So God bless you, community family.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you for listening. Thank you for coming, Chris.
Yo, great.
Was bound to